Okay, if you have your Bibles, let's go over to Luke chapter 15, okay? Here we go, Luke chapter 15. And what we're going to find in Luke chapter 15 is a parable over here that deals with a life situation concerning a man that had two sons. And in those two sons, he was a very wealthy man. He was a Christian man. He had raised both of his sons in the Christian to be a Christian, trust Christ as your Savior, fine. Everything is fine until the younger son decides he's going to take off and he's going to live it up in the world. And God put this in here to show a true life situation and what happened. And the reason I wanted to bring this out was because it shows not only how the father dealt with this, he had two things to deal with. His son running off after he had everything just so he could live it up and give me my inheritance, Dad. Okay. Dad tried to talk him out of it, but he wouldn't listen. And he took off and Dad gave him his inheritance. But then the brother, when we get down, and we'll have that next week, how he had to deal with his brother, because his brother was furious that his dad treated his son the way that he did so nicely when he came back, that he was jealous. Now he had to deal with a second son who was filled full of jealousy, didn't want anything, accused his dad of having preference and loving the one more than the other and all this kind of thing. But I thought it would be very interesting because this father had sense. He handled the situation, and what this can apply when we go down through this is this. Number one, whether it be your son, or whether it be a neighbor, or whether it be a friend of yours that's gotten off on with him, he went and used all of his money for the harlot. The harlot is a whore. That's what they call it. And you'll find out he went to live it up. He got his inheritance. Man, he blew that like you wouldn't believe. So we're going to cover some of the things he did that you're seeing people do right here today with young people because they don't have parental training at home and faithfulness of dads to do what they're supposed to do. So let's begin. All right. Here we go. We're over here to Luke here in chapter 15. And what we're going to do, hold your place there. Because this is what the dad taught and did for the son, both of these sons. And then we're going to get down to the nitty-gritties here about the son taking off. Okay? Here we go. Okay, these here we probably went over before, but we're going to give you some of these here. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 4, verse 1 to 7. Now keep your place in Luke, okay? And we're just going to show you what this man did. Okay? This is the kind of fellow that he was. He's a good father. Had a lot of money. God had blessed him. And he had hired servants. I mean, he was really blessed and treated them great. They had more to eat than what they could eat. And he was good to them, you see. So we come over to Proverbs chapter 4 and verses 1 to 7, okay? Here's what we read. Hear ye children the instructions of the father and attend to no understanding. For I give you good doctrine, forsake ye not my law. Well, fathers, you got to have a law to lay down for them not to forsake, right? That's what we don't have in homes today, many homes. Right. Then, for I was my father's son, tender and only beloved, and in the sight of my mother. He taught me also, and said unto me, let thine heart retain thy words, and keep my commandments, and live. That's one of the first promises in the Bible there, you know, is to follow the Lord and so forth and have long life. Get wisdom and get understanding and forget it not, neither decline from the words of my mouth. Forsake her not, and she shall preserve thee. Love her, and she shall keep thee. Well, what is it we're to love? We're talking about a woman? No, we're talking about wisdom. In verse 7, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. In other words, God give you a brain, put it in gear, start using it, and realize what you're teaching is going to produce a product. Even if that son rebels, you're free. God doesn't hold you responsible if you brought them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. Your hands are clean. You are to teach your children to leave the home. That's where you raise children. You teach them values and things that when they leave, they have something to build their life on. That's why you train them. Okay, let's look at a couple other things. Let's go here in chapter 2, verse 6 to 11. Okay, Proverbs chapter 2, verse 6 to 11. This is what this man did. Chapter 2 here, verses 6 to 11. Here we go. For the Lord giveth wisdom out of his mouth, and he cometh, out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler, or safety, to them that walk uprightly. He keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of his saints. Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment, equity, and yea, every good path. When wisdom entereth into thine heart and knowledge is pleasant unto thy soul, discretion shall preserve thee and understanding shall keep thee. So forth. This man in Luke 15 understood that and he taught that to both of his sons. All right? Now, let's go on to look at something else while we're here in Proverbs. Just a couple more here. We find out here in chapter 22, verse 6. Okay, let's go here, Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. Because they're going to do what they want to do unless you tell them what they're doing is wrong. No, you're going to teach them not to do what they want to do. 22:6 says this. Train up the child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Sad to say, we got a lot of children out there today that have not been trained up in the Lord, so when they get old, they'll keep right on departing from it because they had no training at home saying, no, that was wrong. You're not to do that. You say, one more verse, okay, 29, 15, and 17. Right here, just go a couple more pages here. 29 and verse 15. The rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself bringeth his mother to shame. In verse 17, correct your son, and he shall give thee rest, and yea, he shall give delight unto thy soul. Well, I'm going to say this. As a Christian, you can raise your children. We'll say you had four. Well, I'm just using this as an illustration. We'll say that we had a man had four children. And you raised them all the same way. And one of them goes astray. Are you held responsible? No, God says in the Old Testament that I don't have to hold the sins of the children liable for the father. Not if you've taught them right. You can't live their life after they leave. I mean, they're free. The only thing they've got to go on from right and wrong is what you've taught them. Period. That's it. You are it. The man is held responsible. Boy, did I have to learn that. I surely did. But anyway, as we go on here, let's go here to the 15th chapter here, and let's begin up here in verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth for me. And he divided them unto them his living. Hey, I got an inheritance coming here. I want mine now, Dad. I want it. You see, then we're going to find out. In verse 13 is very interesting. In verse 13. But the thing about that, he didn't leave immediately. Notice in verse 13, and not many days after the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. Not many days. We don't know how not many days, but it surely wasn't tomorrow because the days is in the plural, and we find out a short time. I mean, this kid was getting ready to go, and he had it with Dad at home and so forth. He wanted to see the world and understand what's going on and so forth like that. So, you'll find out, he didn't throw up his hands and leave this decision to his wife to handle, or his son, or his wife, and so forth there. And he fulfilled his own responsibility to the Lord, to his son and to his wife. He didn't pass it on to the mom. This is my responsibility. and I'm going to take full responsibility for it, and I'm going to handle the situation because I am the head of the house. Wouldn't it be nice if we had men like that today? Yeah. Now, we do have some, but they're not in the multitude, I'll sure tell you that. Just look around here, this area here. They're not in the multitude, but there are some good men here who do this. He said, I'm not fluffing it off on Mom, my wife, my responsibility, I'll take care of it. So, life is made up of testings and of blessings. Now, let's go on down to verse 13. He didn't leave immediately. Again, not many days after the younger son gathered all together. I mean, he's getting everything ready to go here. And he took his journey into a far country. I got to get away from Dad as far as I can. I got to get away from this. I know I'm fortunate, but anyway, I got to get away from him. I want to live it up. There's things I haven't seen. There's things I haven't done and so forth there. And so away that he went. Now, we find out here that once we raise our children, we raise them to leave, and then it is their responsibility to do with what we have taught them. It is not our responsibility anymore. We can try to encourage them and do that, but as far as living their life for them, you can't, because Romans chapter 12, we find out, Romans chapter 12, in chapter 14 and verse 12, each one of us as a Christian, and this son was a Christian that left, but he got with the wrong crowd, and that was his downfall. You can mark it down. You will become who you associate with, and so mark it down. Next thing we'll look at here as we go on here, he trusted the Lord as we read on down. He took his journey to a far country, and there he wasted his substance with riotous living. And the word riotous in the Greek literally means anything that's dishonoring to the Lord. You've just wasted your time. If we come on down, you'll find out here when when he did come back. Look in verse 30 over here, if you will, because it makes it pretty plain that when a young man who is not married takes off, first of all, he wants money and he wants women. Mark it down. That's what he wants. Now, but as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. His daughter was, his father really was welcoming him back and killed the fatted calf and so forth. This is the other son that accused his father because he was jealous. That, hey, he threw his whole life away here. He went out here with the harlots and so forth. In fact, that's sort of interesting, where it comes from, harlots. And sort of interesting, could the dad do anything? No, he couldn't do a thing until he made a decision to come back himself. So let's go on down, okay, in verse 14. Now, when he did that, or hold your place there, do you put this little reference here because it's a warning. And this guy, this son fulfilled it. I mean, he really did. Go back to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2 in your Bible. Clear back to the end of your Bible here. 1 John, and then Jude, and then Revelation. But 1 John 2:15. Now, we're going to find out that in 1 John 2:15 says this, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, that's the lust of the flesh. That's the lust of the eyes, and that's the pride of life. Lust of the flesh is, hey, I love women. I've never had an affair with a woman before, but I'm going to find out what it's like. Sort of straight talk, isn't it? But that's what happens. Then, what about the lust of the eyes? Oh man, I'll tell you, look at all these other people having fun. You're seeing this on television today. Look at all the stuff with Budweiser and so forth and all of these things here on drinking and the naked women and everything else there. Oh, they're just having a great time. Just having a great time. Man, I'd like that too. And then the pride of life. Look, I can make something out of myself, but I can't be with Dad and be tied down and all this sort of thing here. And there, I'm going out and I'll make something of my life myself. Everything has to do with the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and so forth. I'm going to do it myself, and I don't need the Lord, and I don't need my dad, and I don't need my brother, who's a crank anyway, but he really turned out to be a little bit jealous there. Well, that's sort of interesting. So, in Romans chapter 5, verse 20, the Father knew this much, that where sin is, grace abounds, grace doeth much more abound. Other words, by the grace of God, God will take him back to where he can be used for the rest of his life. But he had to learn a lesson. He had to learn a lesson. And his parents couldn't keep him from learning a lesson because he had a mind that was made up that he wanted to have fun in life and the heck with the training that he has had. You see that today, in some cases. So anyway, to make a long story short, I'm going to give you some things here that he went after. Okay? So you'll know. Now, he was in bad shape. But he didn't fare too well. I'd like for you to hold your place in 15, because we're going to come back. But I'd like to take you on where he went. Now, first of all, the only thing the dad could do is to pray for his son. In Philippians 4, 6, and 7, pray for everything. Pray, pray, pray. Do we pray for our son? Oh, yes. But we can't live our life. And usually, when you get in a situation like this, somebody else can do more with your son than you can with yourself. Usually. So we're praying some other Christian will get to talk to him and try to talk some sense into him that he needs to get back. Because he's not a young man anymore. He's not a young man. Get back to the days when he was a teenager, when he was at home and winning people to the Lord Jesus Christ, and all these years he's throwing right down the drain. Wood, hay, and stubble. No gold, silver, precious stones. Just live everything for himself. People with the wrong crowd, and so forth. So anyway, let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 6, okay? 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 14. I want to read this, and then we'll go to 1 Timothy 4, 6. In the 14th verse, and when he had spent all, hey, all that money, all that inheritance that I got from Dad, when he had spent all of that, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Isn't it funny, God can send a famine when it needs be to open the eyes and sort of let this young man know that you're not going to make it on your own, bub. You know, but he had to learn a lesson. So we go back here to 1 Timothy chapter 6. Okay, get back here. 1 Timothy here in chapter 6. Okay, 1 Timothy chapter 6 here in verse 10. It was said, for the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Money is not the sin. It's the love of it that you're going to use it for your own pleasure. And there's nothing wrong with taking a vacation and that and buying a skirt or a man buying a suit. There's not, we're not even talking about that. We're talking about living it and taking your money and using it for the devil's joy, which always turns out to be a very sorrowful end when it ends up. You see? All right? The love of money is the root of all evil. Now, let's go to Luke chapter 12. We're back here. We just back up a couple of chapters here, okay? And this is the way the boy went. Could have been thinking. Luke chapter 12 and verse 13 to 21. Let's read back here. We got another man back here about, could be the same shape as the son was. I don't know. So we pick it up here in Luke chapter 12. We'll begin here in verse 13. All right? We got chapter 12 here. I'm in 13. We're back up one here. Chapter 12. Here we go here. In verse 13, and one of the company said unto him, that's Christ, hey, master, speak to my brother that he divides the inheritance with me. He's got an inheritance company, but I want half of it. You know. Okay. And he said unto him, man, who made me a judge or a divider over you? Handle your own problems. And he said unto them, take heed. Now I want to give you a little advice here. The Lord says, beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. And he spake a parable unto them. A parable comes from the Greek paraboa and means an illustration of a literal experience. It's paraboa laid alongside of to illustrate a spiritual truth. Okay? He's going down. And he thought within himself, and he said here in verse 16, he spake a parable unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentiful. Other words, crops turned out good. Made a lot of money. And he thought within himself, saying, well, what shall I do? Because I don't have any more room where to bestow my fruits. And he said, now he's going to reason this thing out with himself. And he said, this will I do. I will pull down my barns, and I'll build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. I'll tear down the old barns, going to build a bigger barns to put all of this in. Man, I'm making headway. Oh, yeah, you sure are. And I will say to my soul, or myself, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Now he's still prospering. I mean, he's got some stuff laid up for many years, and he's still raking it in, brother. I got to tear down barns and put some more so I can keep raking it in, you know. And boy, money is his God. The love of money is the root of all evil, which while some have coveted after, and erred from the faith, pierced himself through with many sorrows. Whoopie-doopie-doo. So let's go on down. There's always but the Lord. Always but the Lord. So, he says, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thy ease. Eat, drink, and be merry. That's what he said to himself. Hey, I got all of this. Man, I'm going to live her up. Do anything I want to do. I can buy anything I want to buy. And whatever it is, I'm going to get it. If it will satisfy the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, the lust of the flesh, I will live for self. The only problem with that is, but God. Now, Revelation 1:18, the Bible says, I'm he that liveth, that's Christ. I was dead, and I'm alive forevermore. And I have the keys of two things, of hell, that's the location, and of death. I have the keys to that. When I say it's time to go, you're going to go. God can do that. I'm the ultimate man. I remember a Bible teacher, Dr. Mark Cameron, was talking about a lady at 70, and she went in, and anyway, they diagnosed her and said, you've got about a year to live or less. Well, she died 14 years later. Doctors can be wrong. So, anyway, let's go on down. But God, now let's see what God says about this whole thing. If you don't want anything to do with me, God says, it's fine. You're just living for everything you can do to fulfill lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, the pride of life. Okay. But what you didn't realize, sir, you're not alive because of yourself. You're alive because I have permitted you and blessed you, and now it has turned you into an absolute, I should say, enemy of mine, because this is all you're living for. Just everything you can get out of life, go out and have all your fun and everything else. But let's see what God said. He said unto him, you're a fool, first of all, because this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then who shall those things be which thou hast provided? You'll live for it, but you'll never enjoy it, sir. You'll never enjoy it. This is what this son went after. Now, there's one other thing that we're going to look at here. We go over here to Proverbs. I want to take you back to Proverbs, okay, if you will. The Old Testament, because money and women are two things that can get a guy off base real, real fast. Going back here to Proverbs chapter 6, we're going to look at verse 32, okay? Chapter 6 and verse 32, all right? It says here, but in verse 32, Proverbs chapter 6, but whoso committeth adultery with a woman lacketh understanding. He that doeth it destroyeth his own soul. A wound and dishonor shall he get, and his reproach shall not be wiped away. Now it talks about adultery with another man's wife, and then trying to, if you get caught, to do something in order to make it right. But God says there's nothing you can do. In verse 34, for jealousy is the rage of a man. Therefore, he will not spare in the day of vengeance. In other words, if you had an affair with my wife, you better not turn your back. Then God says, he will not regard any ransom, neither will he rest content, though thou givest him many gifts. There's not one thing you can do if you have an affair with another man's wife. You're in trouble. Real trouble. Pray he's not like some of these idiots who go out here and get a gun and say, I'll tell you what, I'll take care of that. And then go down the road, you don't know, or one of his buddies, and he pulls up side of you to pass you in the car and pulls out a shotgun and kablooey, you're dead and off into eternity. Those things happen, folks. You know, you'd be better off going to some woman who's not married, but you don't go to a man's wife. That's a very dangerous thing. That's what God says. Now, another thing very interesting. Let's go here to chapter 7, verse 4, okay? Right down here, if you will. In chapter 7 here, we find out here, in verse 4 to 27. Boy, we're going to read several verses here because this really nails things down. Okay? Let's begin in verse 4. Say unto wisdom, thou art my sister, and call understanding my kinswoman. In other words, we need to get related to wisdom and understanding, that they may keep thee from the strange woman, from the stranger which flattereth with her words. For at the window of my house I looked through my casement. Isn't that something? And beheld among the simple ones, I discerned among the youths, a young man void of understanding. This would be the brother that left. He's one of the victims here. Young and man, I'm full of vigor and stuff here. I want to find out what a woman's like. Okay. Well, she'll invite you. Passing through the street near her corner, and he went the way to her house. In the twilight, in the evening, in the black and the dark night, and behold, there met him a woman with the attire of a harlot and subtle of heart. Well, harlots or whores are usually dressed with not much on above and not much on below, and the back is open and the front is open, and she has nice looking, she's not overdone, but she is the most attractive thing you've ever seen of a woman. That's what they do. And behold, there met a woman with the attire of a harlot and subtle of heart. Because she's going to dress that way because she wants to entice you to come into her so she can make some money off of you. And you're a fool, God says. She is loud and stubborn. Her feet abide not in her house. Now is she without, now in the streets, and lieth in wait at every corner. And she caught him and kissed him, and with an impudent face said unto him, I have peace offerings with me. have I paid my vows? I've been to the Catholic Church. Hey, I've got peace offerings. I confess to the priest. I paid my vows. I send them some money too. They're very happy. They don't care what I do when I leave the church, just as long as I pay my vows. And there, some churches are like that. Pastors will turn their head and everything else. They won't preach anything the Bible says. If it comes to things like this, they're not going to do that, because you're a big giver in the church, you know. So they're bought out, some of them, not all of them. I have peace offerings with me, and this day have I paid my vows. So he's telling this young boy, he says, you know, we're all right with God. I've taken care of that. Therefore came I forth to meet thee diligently to seek thy face, and I have found thee. In other words, I've been looking for a man just like you. She's a liar, isn't she? But I've been looking for a man like you. You're the kind of man I want, and I finally found you. I've decked my bed with coverings of tapestry and carved works with fine linen of Egypt. I mean, my bed is got the finest coverings on it that you'll ever see. I have perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. In other words, I'll tell you what, I smell like something you want. You know, just like men put on their aftershave lotion, women put on their perfume and so forth, and thank God for it. But there's a difference between overloading it for the attraction of men and putting it on so that you take care of yourself and present yourself as a wonderful Christian lady. There's nothing wrong with that, but not the other way. Come, let us take our fill of love until morning, and let us solace ourselves with loves. You're the only one that I really want a relationship with, because I found the man that I've been looking for, and here you came, and I paid my vows, and God sent you to me. Oh, my goodness gracious. Come, let us take our fill of love until morning, and let us solace ourselves with love. For the good man is not at home, and he's going a long journey. Oh, good night, I didn't know she was married. Oh, boy, oh, boy. Well, it doesn't make any difference, because she wouldn't do it if she thought she was going to get caught. And he always keeps his word, and he doesn't come home until he says he's going to come home. So we're all safe, and by the way, she's paid her vows to the church and everything like that. Why shouldn't I have a good time? I mean, after all, I'm not married. It's her problem. But if she wants me and just met me and I'm more attractive than what her husband is that she lives with, I'm pretty special. I bet that young man sort of thought something like that. Suppose? Mm-hmm. Then he hath taken a bag of money with him, and he will come home at the day appointed. Well, it isn't going to be while he's there at her house having an affair with her. So she knows that. She doesn't want to get caught. She just wants to have a good time, make a little money. With her much fair speech, she caused him to yield. With the flattering of her lips, she forced him. He goeth after her straightway as an ox goeth to the slaughter, or as a fool to the correction of stocks, till a dart strike through his liver. The liver is pretty hard to repair. I think when the liver goes, you're just about had it. You know. Oh, you can get a new lung, you can get hearts repaired and so forth like that, and things. But till a dart strike through his liver, as a bird hasteneth to the snare, and knoweth not that it is for his life. Hearken unto me now, therefore, O ye children, and attend to the words of my mouth. Now this is the Lord speaking now. Let not thine heart decline to her ways. Go not astray in her paths. She hath cast down many wounded. In other words, she's broke up many, many homes and so forth. Many wounded. I wondered if they had AIDS then, because I will tell you something, one of the greatest books ever written, and other things she's got off on, but she wrote one by Dr. Lorraine Day concerning when AIDS was first found, and all the people that those men with AIDS found out they couldn't be cured went and gave blood and passed it on to hundreds and hundreds and thousands of people.
Yeah.
That you're not going to hear the government tell you about that, because that happened when it first came in. I have known men that have lived this kind of life and ended up with venereal disease, gonorrhea, syphilis, things that some of the medicines that would cure that don't work anymore. And then I found out, and this has been probably 4 or 5 years ago, they give some statistics in Marshall about how many AIDS cases there are in Marshall. So you better be careful who you're going to have an affair with, because you don't know. They look as healthy as you do, they look as attractive as you do, and so do the men. But you have no idea what's between their legs. You have no idea how affected that they are, and so forth. So let's go on. She has cast down many wounded, yea, and many strong men have been slain by her. Instead of staying strong, they lost all their power and so forth. And then it says, her house is the way to hell, going down to the chambers of death. That's interesting. This is what this young man was headed for. Now, her way is the way to hell. It was not the fact with this young man, because he was a Christian. But going down to the chambers of death, he could, if God sees fit to do it, take his life prematurely instead of letting him make an absolute mockery out of God. And sometimes God steps in for that. So, now let's go back to Luke chapter 15, okay? To Luke chapter 15, we'll come here to verse 17, okay? Or there's one more. There's one more I want to take you to. Hang on there. I want to take you to one more. Well, while we're here, go back to Proverbs. Go back there. I'm going to take you one more here, okay? Go back to Proverbs, and we'll go here to chapter 9. I wasn't going to do that, but I think it's a good one. You need to read what God says about some of this stuff here. Proverbs here in chapter 9. Yeah, my pages sticking together here. Okay. Proverbs here, chapter 9, look at verse 13, okay? Then we'll move on fast. In verse 13 says this, a foolish woman is clamorous, she is simple and she knoweth nothing. For she sitteth at the door of her house on the seat in the high places of the city. To call strangers who go right on their ways, whoso is simple, let him turn hither. And as for him that wanteth understanding, she saith to him, stolen waters are sweet. Whatever you steal or whatever, you just use this as an illustration. Whatever you steal, it's sweet and it's good. And bread eateth in secret is pleasant. This is a simply illustration that if you're eating bread, then why would you eat it in secret? Well, you must have stole it, I guess. So, and maybe you're stealing from the Lord, and this is an illustration of it. But he knoweth not that the dead are there, and that her guests are in the depths of hell. Very interesting, isn't it? So, this young man was sort of playing with fire, wasn't he? Yeah, I'll say that he was. Verse 17, we're back here to Luke chapter 15 and verse 17, and then we're going to wind it up right here and get set for next week, okay? In chapter 15 and verse 17, he says this, and when he came to himself, in other words, he got his head on straight here, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? He finally came to himself, and you would pray that every drug addict that ever used drugs or anything else would come to theirself and realize that, brother, you're on a death march. And how wonderful it is when I look around and I see others. Yeah, they go to church, they worship the Lord, they know that Christ is their Savior, and they're trying to win others to Christ. Why am I not doing it? Why am I just worried about myself? I want to make as much money as I can. I want as many women as I can. I'm going to live it up, brother. Lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And I'll show people I'm going to amount to something. But the Lord. And especially for this young man who was a Christian. But he wasn't acting like it, did he? Okay, let's go now. And then we'll close here. How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? Boy, he's reasoning things out now. Man, I'm, what am I doing out here? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. So as God had told him about heaven and the Lord, or he would have said, I've sinned against heaven, which means I have sinned against God. So he had some good training at home, did he not? Sure. And am no more worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of the hired servants. And he arose and he came to his father. And we find out, but when he was a great way off, and I'm going to stop there because we're going to finish this with the next part. We'll just finish the verse. He arose and he came to his father, but when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and he ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. It amazes me. Because his father could have said, here comes that renegade. Here comes my son. I'm ashamed of him to even call him my son. Now I'll wait till he comes and I'm going to tell him, did you learn a lesson, buddy? I could handle it that way. But that wasn't the way his dad handled it. Because first of all, if the son came back, the past is over. You want to be so thankful when a person says, you know, you've done this, but I want to get back with the Lord. Period. Isn't that wonderful? Now, you don't keep throwing it up, but this father, and I hate to say this, but I wouldn't want to see a dad or a person like you and I to see somebody hooked on drugs, doing things they shouldn't do, their life is going to be a mess and so forth, they're not serving the Lord, they're just running here, running there, what, who knows? And then, when they came to their senses and said, look, I got to settle myself down. I need to get in a church. I need to go back with Dad. I need to go back with Mother. And I had all of these things. and now I'm broke. I hope, dear Lord, I don't have a venereal disease. I'm just throwing that in for our time now. And to do that. But the father didn't say, here comes the bomb. You know, I hope you learned the lesson. No, he didn't treat you that way. And he didn't wait for him to come. He was so happy to see his son that he was now coming back home and to be a part of the family, have his inheritance, have plenty to eat, and not have to worry about starving to death or anything else. And then, as time goes on, God would bring him a nice woman. But God's not going to give a good woman to the trash of the earth for a man to ruin. He's not going to do that, you see. So, here he comes, and his dad's so happy. It's over. You're coming back. That's all his dad thought about. You're coming back. That's the greatest thing. You're coming back to the Lord. You realize that you've sinned against heaven. You realize what you did to God. You realize, yes, I was heartbroken, but you're my son, and I'm not going to wait for you to come back. Man, I see you coming. I'm going to run to you and let you know how welcome you are and how thrilled I am to have you back. And son, the past is over. Let's begin anew. Amen? I think this father is a good example of what you and I should be, and I think that we will, seeing somebody, even though it's not our son or daughter, it's somebody else's son or daughter, that we could do anything that we possibly could to welcome them back or into our church, that will be treated like we are so glad to see them and would do anything in the world to help them. Now, this father has another big problem to face, and we'll get on that next week and show you how that he handled it. Most important thing in the world is this. Don't you thank God for these things, which he said, I put these things in here for our learning and admonition. So you'll know there's things going on. You'll know my opinion about it. You'll know what a good father did. You'll know how it's handled. Isn't it wonderful to have these things in the Bible to be able to read and to look at and say, you know what? I can't live somebody else's life, but I can be and let them know that I don't care what they've done. We are so happy to have them back. When the son, there's nothing you can do until the person says, I'm sorry, Lord, for the way I treated you, I was wrong. And I want to get back and to do things and to serve you the way you want me to do. But now if you're watching and you don't know you're going to heaven, here's how it is. The billfold sin and I'm the sinner. God says we're all sin. It comes short of the glory of God. Because I don't care what your position is. I don't care how much money you got or how you're looked upon in the community. You're on your way to hell unless you do one thing. God made it possible to give you an absolute free gift and a free road to heaven, and you don't have to do one thing except accept it. Jesus Christ came from heaven to earth so that he could go to the hell of the cross to pay for your sins and mine. And he put it in the Bible, and the last words he had before he gave his life, after going through all of that hell on the cross and so forth, being spit in the face, given many good to drink, crown of thorns, struck down, he couldn't even recognize Christ. His face. He said it was a joy in Hebrews. It was a joy to do this for you. He goes, if I didn't get it for you, there's no other way you could go to heaven. You would be in hell for all time and eternity. And I came from heaven to earth to buy your right to go to heaven and offer to anybody for whosoever will may come. Aren't you glad that you were one who came? Really? That you have a home in heaven and you know that God loves you so much that he went to the hell of the cross so you don't have to go to a literal hell, the lake of fire. He said, I'll take your sin max and I'll be paid. Don't go to hell and pay for your own. Will you believe and trust, put your faith in me that I'm telling you the truth? You will never perish. God loved the world. I'm part of it. Gave his only begotten son, Jesus Christ, for the sins of the world. That whosoever believeth in him, dear Lord, I thank you daily for paying for my sin, or I would be on my way to hell, never a chance to get out. For promising me, whosoever believeth in him should never perish but have everlasting life. If you've never done that, I just would encourage you to do this without a word of prayer. Okay? So let's everybody bow, and we're going to close this morning here. And we'll pick it up next week with the other problem that this man had to face and how he handled it. Dear Lord, thank you so much. Give us a good day today. And I thank you, dear Lord, for writing these things in the Bible. It's an encouragement to me that I need to do the right thing when it comes to others out here. We're saturated with drugs. We're saturated with immorality. We're saturated with all kind of stuff here that is contrary to happiness. It's only temporarily. But for happiness that's going to last, I've got to do, dear Lord, the way you say to do it, or it's disaster in my life. I thank you. Bless each one here today. Thank you for a nice day, dear Lord. And we'll look forward to having a good week, and give us an opportunity to witness to somebody and invite them to church. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right.
We welcome your comments. You may write to the Heritage Baptist Church, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, 56180. That address again is Heritage Baptist Church, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, 56180.